Good evening and welcome to this evening's meeting of the Westerville City Schools Board of Education. We're delighted to have each and every one of you. Tonight, there will be two opportunities to address the board. The first one needs to pertain to action items on the agenda, and the second one does not. And with that, Mr. Griffith, will you please call the roll?
Mr. Byrd, Dr. French.
Here.
Dr. Nestor Baker.
Here.
Mr. Velardo, Mrs. Davidson.
Here. Will you please join us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, up first, district highlights and recognitions. We do not have any tonight. 4.01, approval of the meeting, of the minutes of the regular meeting of the Board of Education on September 14th. Any questions, comments? Bart, consider those approved. And up first, 5.01, all-day kindergarten report. And Barbara Wallace is going to talk to us first.
Good evening, President Davidson, Dr. Kellogg, members of the board, and Mr. Griffith. This evening, I will be presenting a brief update on our all-day kindergarten program. Last year, the board determined that we would move forward with all-day kindergarten on a limited basis of 10 classrooms. We proceeded with selecting the students for the program through a random selection process and had over 400 applicants. Participating families pay $3,000 per year in 10 installments for the program or may qualify for a waiver based on income limitations. This slide shows you the locations of our kindergarten classes at this time. I thought you might be interested to see this. Across the top is the home school. If you look at the bottom column, it tells you how many students in each of those schools are attending an all-day kindergarten program. And then as you scroll up, you can see where. For example, if you go to Hawthorne, you see at the bottom, there are 41 students from kindergarten, all-day kindergarten. Two of them attend at Elcott, one at Amherst, one at Charrington, 23 at Hawthorne, 13 at Longfellow, and one at Robert Frost. This is just an approximate cost of staffing for licensed, classified, and total staffing costs. We're currently serving 257 students. 122 of these students are on fee waivers, that's 47%. We expect a revenue of approximately $407,000. I thought this was a fun slide too. This shows us how many students got their first choice. These are a few demographics. Our first column shows the number of students on waivers in each class and then the percent. The second column is the school's free and reduced lunch count. The third column is how many males to females. We had several more males than females in this class. And the last column is the number of English second language students that we have. A couple of comments before I turn the floor over to our teachers. The startup of all-day kindergarten went smoothly in our home buildings. Longfellow presents some interesting challenges that we work through and continue to work through. I have met with all of our all-day kindergarten teachers to hear their perspective on how the beginning of this year has gone. They candidly shared the positives and suggestions for moving forward. The All-Day Kindergarten Oversight Committee has met once and will meet again in October. The committee will gather data, monitor our all-day kindergarten program, and make recommendations for next year. We would like to present to the board again around winter break to get board feedback and planning for next year. Next, I have two teachers I'd like to introduce. We have with us tonight Erin Holloway from All-Day Kindergarten at Hawthorne and Amy Clifton, our All-Day Kindergarten teacher at Whittier.
Good evening. Thank you for having us tonight. We're just going to talk a little bit about our perspective of All-Day Kindergarten so far. We brought some pictures to show you, so we're just going to talk through a little bit about what these pictures mean in our all-day program. The very first picture, I think, is kind of a combination picture of stations and Hat Day at Whittier. So one thing we just wanted to mention about that is the kindergartners feel a more part of the school environment. A lot of time when you're in half-day kindergarten, especially in the PM class, you don't hear the announcements. Sometimes those notes don't get sent home on the correct day because they kind of miss out. And so sometimes the teachers and the parents miss out on a little bit, and the kids don't feel as a part of the whole school environment. So now that they're there full day, they feel kind of more just like the big kids. They get to do what they do and participate in all the events and activities that they get to. The center picture is a picture of the lunch line and a fifth grade buddy helping our kindergartners reach those very high shelves. But you know, just that they're learning routines that they wouldn't have learned in half day kindergarten. So this is their first experience going through a lunch line and eating lunch and getting to go outside for recess without their teacher. So that's kind of fun for them. And the third picture on this slide is a field trip to Innes Woods. I think this is one of our most exciting things about all-day kindergarten is, having that time to spend at a field trip. In half-day kindergarten, you know, it takes, 20, 30 minutes for a bus ride to get to a location. Usually, when you're there, it's usually an hour field trip, sometimes more, and then another half an hour or so back to the school. That's your whole half day. So you kind of get to school, you get rushed off, you get thrown at a field trip. We probably have to cut half of it out, run around, come back, and throw them on another bus to go home. So it's a very, very rushed day for half day, even though they still get that experience. Now on full day, we got to go, spend as much time there as we wanted, take as long as we wanted, sit down and have a picnic lunch, come back, and then discuss the field trip right then and there on the same exact day, and have some more time at school. So it was a lot more that they were able to process and soak in and enjoy.
The other part about all-day kindergarten, which has been wonderful, is getting the gift of time. With our large class sizes being at 26 this year, it's been nice to make them into small groups and not feel like we're rushed through our literacy and to do our guided math centers. So here are some pictures of the children where they're doing the hands-on. We have technology that we get to pilot and try to use, and it's nice to have that time during the day to do so, where we can keep the kids in small groups and really individualize, differentiate so they're ready for first grade. And they're understanding how to go through the centers and doing sight words and just really trying to collaborate, pulling our buddies from the other grade levels in so they're getting those relationships as well. And then we have another picture of the lunch there. And that's really about it.
I think it is. Yep,
because Erin kind of covered it.
Yep, sure, too.
Yep.
What's the guy with the Superman shirt doing there?
Well, he is writing his letters using shaving cream because we have time to wash our hands after that center as well.
Yeah, we definitely get to do messier things because we have more time to clean up afterwards.
More of the hands-on, not always paper pencil, because that's how we learn, being hands-on.
Do you have any questions for us?
Just a couple. What thus far has been most surprising to you about moving to all day?
say probably my first day not doubling everything, not feeling like I'm rushed, that I have to set the room up. I set it up for one set of kids, so everything in that room pertains to them. Doing half day, when I did calendar, I had two calendars. So every kid comes in the afternoon thinking, well, who's in my room in the morning? So they kind of have ownership. It makes it their community. I can put more of their belongings and their learning tools that they already understand. So that's been a positive for me.
I think that was a huge, we met as all-day kindergarten teachers just a couple weeks ago, and I think that was a huge surprise to everybody was, you know, we have been so used to many years rushing and getting stuff done. And so, you know, we got to the second half of the day, and we're so used to talking a mile a minute that we were like, wow, we got 2 hours left. And it was a little hard to think, wow, you know, we can slow down, we can take more time, we can review more things, we can have a little bit more fun with them. So I think that was pretty hard for all of us, I think, that those first couple of weeks. So
you showed some demographics, and the one I'm going to ask you may not have access to that information. Do you know what percentage, and Barb, you may know, may not, what percentage of the kids in the all-day program had preschool experience?
I think it's about 60%.
So it pretty much holds with the average for the state of Ohio? Okay. Thank you.
No particular questions about your day, because I can hear what you're saying about the day being more organized, and you feel like, you know, at the end of the day you've actually completed something, you don't have to repeat and repeat. But a question about the second slide, Barb, if I don't know if we can go back to that or not. We kind of skipped over that quickly. There was one with the cost factor, I think. Maybe a second or third slide.
One with the $407,000.
That was the income, I think.
Yeah.
Total
staffing cost was $493,000.
Oh, is that what it was? I don't remember. It was like gone.
One before that one, yeah.
And there it is, yeah. Okay, that's the staffing cost. Okay, that's what you had. And I gotcha. And then you said the income was $407,000, which is really interesting that, you know, we came even with those that are fit the reduced cost. So thank you. I appreciate that.
This, again, remember now, this includes opening a whole other building, too, because that took secretaries and all the support staff, and that's in there as well.
Yeah.
So, yeah, from a financial standpoint, general fund didn't take much of a hit in order to put this together, so, which is what we projected.
Well, and also, we would have been incurring some of those costs anyway, because the kids would have been half day. So as we look at it, it suggests to me, just kind of ballpark, that it's pretty much a wash. Which is a good wash.
Yeah. So I have a couple questions. I'm sorry.
Go ahead. No.
This feels really loud. Is it? No? Okay. How important are the peer models in your school?
Are you talking like the older students?
Mm-hmm.
Well, they're very important. So when we can involve them, like mine really right now only help during lunch, it's just a way for, one, those kids to get exposure into being a leader. So we've chosen some of our leadership students in the building, and just some kids that have, you know, are doing something really great in the fifth grade classrooms, because I eat lunch with fifth grade, that, you know, sit down and make sure my kids know what to grab, how to grab it, you know, how to walk and hold it with two hands. And those kindergartners, like I said, it's an experience they've never had. So, you know, just having some buddies to help them, definitely, you know, they wouldn't be able to do it without them. So I know a lot of adults helped the first couple weeks. Mm-hmm. I think I was in there for 3 weeks. So, but the kids have really taken ownership, and it runs very smoothly now. And I know you have them in your classroom, correct? Some?
They come down and help out as well. And our older kids, too, we've been grateful for the good weather around lunchtime, so we haven't had to do indoor recess with the 5 and 6-year-olds yet. But we have the older kids even come in and teach it something so basic that for people to teach them how to do indoor recess games, how to teach them how to do school. which we always saved in the springtime for the big kids to come down to teach the kindergartners. But now they get to start doing that right now. And we have helpers that help them get to the classrooms. And so it is, it's very positive to have those extra hands. And for the buildings that don't have those older kids, I'd like to also say thank you to you guys, because you guys have stepped in and found some community support to help our buildings that don't have the big kids, to give some extra hands in there too. So thank you for recognizing that for us.
So what do you think of the cutoff date for kindergartners, honestly?
We've done some research on that many a times and presented that, but because I think we all believe as kindergarten teachers, we would rather have the cutoff date at August 1st.
Okay.
Just because now that we've started our school year earlier, maybe not just because, but even more so because now that we start our school year earlier, we have some children that are 4 years old until almost the end of the first quarter. And while I'm not saying every four-year-old, isn't ready for kindergarten, I'm not saying that at all, because I've had some even early entrance students that have been just fine. But I would say a majority of children, I think one more year of maturity would benefit them, especially for their rigorous curriculum that we now have with the Common Core, which is why we also have pushed so hard for all day, because with what we need to teach them now, we feel like this time that we've now been partly given across the district, it's really going to benefit our kindergartners.
Okay.
Our all-day kindergarten committee will be taking data and looking just at birth dates to see how many children fall into that, and then also looking at how many of those children in first grade, where did they come into first grade, to see if there is a difference.
So that. And who makes up that committee?
Erin is on that committee. We have two principals on that committee. We have a parent on that committee. I'm not good at remembering things. Amy's on that committee. There's going to be about seven or eight of us.
Okay.
Anybody else, if you know of anyone interested?
Track the data.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I think an important part too, because I've had situations where I've had four-year-olds come in and they academically are truly ready and mature. I think I would also love to see, which we'll discuss in the committee too, is starting to explain to parents, now that we know what an all-day kindergarten, and starting to get our, ourselves more acquainted with it, I think educating the parents in the springtime and telling them this is what the all-day looks like, and is your child, if it's an option, if they get to choose half-day versus all-day, this is what the program looks like. Last year, we didn't know what it was going to look like. We knew what we wanted it to look like, and I think inviting parents and really having those conversations and meetings as much as we can, even in the springtime, would be a benefit before they just sign up for the lottery thinking, oh, it's all day. But what does that all day look like? We can talk about the ones that look tired at the end of the day, the ones, and to listen to those preschool teachers as much as they can and taking their lead.
Do you want to ask them?
No, I have one more thing, but you go ahead.
So here's another question. The potty in your room, how important is that?
It's the only one we're allowed to use now. I compared it to, I told parents, I said, you know what? How many of us send our five-year-old at a restaurant to the restroom by themselves?
Right.
Not many. Usually an older sibling takes them or the parent. This is the first time for lunch. It's the first time recess on their own. It's the first time they use the restroom.
That's honestly
in a group.
Been one of my biggest surprises this year is how fascinated they are with the bathrooms.
Yes.
I was like truly surprised, because in a half day, if I have five kids go to the bathroom once, that's it. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not every single kid. They could care less that it's there. They only go if they truly have to go. I mean, this year I literally had every single kid wanting to go every 5 minutes, and I was like, what is so different? And I'm so shocked. We actually now have to even take scheduled bathroom breaks in the hallway, because I have only one bathroom and 26 kids. So I even have to go in the bathroom to take a scheduled break, because my children are just fascinated. And I think it's just part of them, their mind wanders. And, when you're so busy, that's the first thing you think of. It's like being thirsty or being hungry or, whatever. It's the first thing you think of. You're sitting there watching a show. Oh, guess what? I'm hungry. Well, no, you're probably not. You're just that's what you're doing. You're sitting down watching a TV show, so you automatically go there. I kind of think it's the same way with the bathroom for my kids. You're sitting down doing a paper, so they all 26 have to come to the bathroom.
And it becomes a thing that you have to teach them to. Just like, you know, we spend almost till November teaching how to line up at the door. So now this is how we use the restroom.
Yeah.
The first week of school
and
was
when
not.
We use the restroom.
Yes. And what is expected and what is appropriate for them. But I also have children that I have one ESL student, one English second language child in my classroom, who actually understands quite a bit. And so for me to communicate that to my children too is very simple. And they knew right from wrong. And then when I told them, I said, you don't go into the restroom and be silly when moms and dads are right there. No, well, we don't do that at school. So setting those expectations, but truly it's the
having
one time
it in
the,
there,
the group
needed.
Visit to the restroom is usually at lunchtime, and that's about it. Other than that, they use it within the classroom. So,
yeah.
Okay.
I was wondering, as you talked about the next report around winter break time, there are a couple of things I'm hoping you'll be able to focus on in the committee. And if not, I understand, but I really would like to know some of this. At that time, I think that you would have some preliminary information that would allow us to take a look at our half day and our whole day and get a sense, for example, of any differences in progress across the standards and behaviors and expectations in kindergarten. Also, the differences in delivery, curricular delivery, between half and full. And it might also be very helpful, whether for this report or the next, to survey parents and get a sense of what sort of behaviors they may be seeing at home, what sort of thoughts, things they see with their children in half versus whole. And I'm not suggesting that one is better than the other, but I think it behooves us to understand very clearly what we have in both examples.
Thank you.
Thanks.
So, Barbara, there's no one from Longfellow? No. I just wondered if they wanted to share. I think it's a totally different building. Is there anything you want to share with us that you would like us to know?
Come to the mic if you would.
Sorry.
I think they did a good job of explaining about some of those surprises we had. They've made such huge growth already, leaps and bounds. We've got a long way to go. I like your description of the restroom. Your parents wouldn't send their children to a bathroom alone. And so, you know, and we're working through those things. So there's been some challenges in that sense, but you know, we're making a lot of progress. The teachers are very positive. We've got a lot of support from the other kindergarten teachers, which has been a huge help too. So,
okay, thank you.
Yes.
And Barbara, I would ask you one more thing when it comes to committee time. I'm wondering what the thought is balancing males to females. Because I did notice it was very heavily male, and if there are issues, not issues, but concerns of balancing. So I think that would be it. Dr. Kellogg, anything you would like to add?
No, I appreciate folks being here and talking open and honestly about challenges that there are things that all the adults who think like adults thought about. And then there's the things that the five-year-olds discover for us that we then have to think about. Little things like portions of playground equipment, restrooms, lineup, all those pieces. And, you know, I know at Longfellow it's a little bit more unique because of the differences in that facility. You don't have the older students there as they did at Hawthorne to serve as mentors. You don't have the bathrooms in the classrooms at that point. And then the data in terms of our classrooms, which represent a lot of the differences between our buildings and our schools, play out there as well. So, and you mentioned the gender distribution, which I'd have to go back and look at the entire pool to see if the pool was skewed more males to females in that same way, because I know the process was random, So did we have data on male to females that was representative of the pool, or was it disproportionate to the pool? And if so, why? If so, we have to call Google, because I think they somehow or another was their fault, since we're using their devices. So I think we got to go through all those. I thought Jeff LaRose and his team, Carrie Dennis, all those folks who had to get that facility up and running, did a fantastic job and have responded since then with modifications to playgrounds and helping out with some other pieces. I think we had some safety concerns with classroom windows and things that they've gone back and retrofitted. Little things, you saw the young kid trying to go through the, I had never thought about the lunch line piece in some kindergarten with their tray up here as they're trying to get their food. You can't even see the food, so how do you know what you're selecting? And we saw the same thing at Longfellow with, well, how high off the floor are the sinks? Those kinds of things that we had to make adjustments for. So we'll continue to tease it out. You know, the board commissioned us to have a committee. Barb's put that together. We'll continue to monitor the all those elements of the program, and at some point, part of that will be what you've asked for tonight, and then the other piece would be if there's opportunities for expansion for next year, if that's where we want to go, what does that look like in terms of classrooms and numbers? At some point, we saturate on classroom space in order to do it, and of course, expansion means FTE to that program, which may mean we don't do FTE to other programs, so there's that Robin Peter to pay Paul, as my mom used to say. That we have to look at. So lots of good things. So September, whatever it is today, September 20-something, hats off to the team, who all the folks who were making that happen, because it really was fabulous to see, and I appreciate their support. So we'll continue to push and ask questions and make it a high-quality program.
Sounds good. Thank you. Okay, up next, 6.01, public comments, and we do not have any. So that takes us to financials. 7.01, resolution to approve the financial reports and investments for August 2015. The financial report lists all funds for August 2015. May I have a motion?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Bart, do you want to talk to us?
Madam President, members of the board, this is the financial report for August 2015. Year-to-date receipts are $58.3 million. This is for general fund only right now. Year-to-date expenditures for general fund is $25.4 million. The unencumbered general fund balance is $85,166,000. If you combine that with all funds, year-to-date receipts are $73.8 million. Year-to-date expenditures are $36 million, and the unencumbered fund balance for all funds is $107,199,000. And that's report for August.
No, Bart.
Okay.
Dr. Nestor Baker?
Yes.
Dr. French?
Yes.
Mrs. Davidson?
Yes. Moving on to 7.02, resolution to approve the final appropriations for fiscal year 2016. May I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Awesome.
Okay, Madam President, members of the board, this is the final appropriations for fiscal year 16, and it's just so you know, it's termed final. If you need to make adjustments, there can be adjustments. It's just called final appropriations, okay? We did the temporary appropriations back in June, and if you remember, for the general fund, we only set them at 75%, so that's the reason we're back here tonight, is because we have to complete those. So to give you a little bit of why we're doing them, is the appropriations have to be from July 1, 2015 to June 30th, 2016. And if you're familiar with my presentations, these look an awful lot like the ones I did last year. I try to keep them consistent. So if you think he's cheating and he's putting the same words up, I do change the numbers.
That's
do
good.
Change the numbers, but it keeps it consistent. General appropriations represent and reflect the assumptions. We try to also stay with the five-year forecast that says that goes along with these as well. It's organized on a fund basis. When we say it's a fund balance, like the general fund is a fund balance, within the funds there are hundreds if not thousands of function codes, But we keep these at the fund balance, and so we're approving these also at the fund balance, and I'll show you that as well. They are, just so you know, broken up into multiple different, like I said, functions, objects, different codes like that. But we approve these at one total balance. Reporting entity, keep in mind, this, the Westerville City is not part of these presentations or part of these. Westerville Public Library are not part of these funds. Sometimes we do some joint things with the library when they want to do a levy or different reasons, but their funds are theirs and ours belong to us. They're not commingled. I did put in here some of the object codes, although you're not really going to see much of those, if any, in this presentation. Back when we did this in June, we had a lot of object codes, when I say 100s for salaries. So they're part of this report, so if somebody wants a refresher, you can see 100s are salaries, 200s are benefits, 300s are not part of the, they don't have 300 codes. 400 funds are object code or purchase services. If you see a 500 object code, it's supplies and materials, capital outlay, whatnot. The fund descriptions, we in our funds, like when we approve these tonight, we actually have 23 pages of funds. Okay, there's general fund, there's state grants, there's federal grants. And what I put in here was a description of those funds. So if you can say, well, gosh, Bart, you don't have 23 pages here. You got multiple in all these different ones. Like for federal grants, you can have 10 or 12, and state grants, and you got student activity grants. But these are the funds and what funds they represent. Here's a summary of the chart of accounts that we have. You can see the general fund is by itself, but if you have special revenue funds, it starts at the 018, 019, 300s. Those are all considered special revenue funds and have special purposes. The federal grants have special purposes, but you also have bond retirements who have special purposes, and that's called debt service funds. And so we tried to break these out, and this is based on the Uniform School Accounting System, part of the state of Ohio. And so this is what we can call our chart of accounts, and every fund we have pertains to those overall funds. Appropriations, again, are at the fund level, and the fund level, again, is based on those chart of accounts, and what we're doing tonight is we have to have these approved by September 30th of 2015 so that we can go forward. And again, if the board decides to do something later in a month or two or different whatever, we can always come back and amend these, but by law, statutorily, you have to have these completed by the end of September. And you can see, people in the back probably can't see all the numbers, and you guys here probably have a hard time seeing these as well. In the general fund, you can notice in appropriations in 7/1/15, we had 111,000. That was 75% of what the appropriations ended last year. With us filling in the blanks this year, we moved those to $154 million. It's a $43 million increase, but the reason being it was we went from 75% to 100%. The rest of the funds, really the only one we tweaked was the self-insurance fund. One of the reasons you're going to see just in the next resolution where we're changing the rates, it only went up 2.4% in medical, so I tweaked that a little bit. So that's really the only thing that changed from what we had done back in the end of June, which to change those amounts. I also gave you a comparison of the fiscal year 15 versus fiscal year 16. You can see the differences. I know it's difficult to read. Really, the difference between fiscal year 15 and 16 was really $2.3 million. A large part, even though the general fund we plugged in here at $8.4 million increase over last year, there were a lot of funds that decreased. You'll notice that the straight A grant last year was $8.3 million. We only have $3 million left to spend this year. I shouldn't say last year. It's what we have. It was a two-year grant. So this grant's winding down, but you can see the differences of what we were in fiscal year 15 versus fiscal year 16 in this grant. This is just the wording. You'll see as part of the in the board report that we put the wording that has to be specific to how much the total, you're approving total funds, not just a general fund. You're approving the total appropriations of $209,633,800. And with that, if there's any questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
Very straightforward, Bart.
Thank you. Okay.
Yep.
No, it's okay. I'm good. I'm thinking actually of the next update to the 5-year forecast and some things that I think we ought to change, but we'll do that another day.
Okay. And we can certainly do that.
Capital.
Yes. Dr. French?
Yes.
Dr. Nestor Baker?
Yes.
Mrs. Davidson?
Yes. Thank you. Moving on, 7.03, resolution to approve the insurance carrier and the rates for medical, dental, and vision insurances. And that's going to be you too, Bart, right?
What's that?
This is yours?
Yes. I need a motion. And a
yep,
second.
Okay, motion.
So moved.
Second.
Madam President, members of the board, every year we have to bring to you changes in insurance rates. In our five-year forecast, we typically put in there a 10% increase, which is what we're being told is the industry standard. Since we've been self-insured the last 2 years, we've sort of beat those odds a little bit. Matter of fact, and this year is no different. We're only increasing 2.4% in healthcare costs total. And to put that in perspective, 10% for us would be $1.6 million. 2.4 is a little between $400,000 and $500,000. So, and if you think about the five-year forecast, Dr. Nestor-Baker, you said we can make changes. That's a 1.1 savings this year, which would compound the next 3 years. So there's a nice savings built in there. So when we do the forecast, we've talked about it should be even better than what we did in May because of the changes we've made. So this is no exception. We're recommending a 2.4% increase. We are staying with medical mutual insurance. The dental rates, we are self-insured in dental as well. Those rates are actually being reduced. Our annual cost next year is being reduced by $12,026. Vision stays the same. And actually the dental, they've actually, not only did they reduce them, they've locked those in the next 3 years. So we have 3 years at that savings. So our rates won't go up for the next 3 years for dental. And vision, I think, is already locked in through 17, I think. So we're sitting pretty good with the medical rates.
The right health now. Insurance was not locked in, though. That was just annually, right?
Correct. Yeah. Correct. Yeah, we review those every year.
Yeah. I'm thinking last year we didn't go up that much.
It wasn't. It was 3.5 or 5. It wasn't a big increase last year either. And I did put in the rate comparisons. If you want to see what every group is paying and the board costs versus the employee costs, it's in your attachments as well. And if anybody watches this at home, they can pull that up. It's in that attachment. They can see those rates as well. And that's it.
So basically our health insurance increased $400,000 minus the $12,000.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. Correct. Thank you. For the
for next calendar
demo.
Year.
Yeah. Okay.
And well under what we had planned for.
Mm-hmm. And in our forecast going forward, we still, if you look at the forecast, it'll say, I think it says 6.4 or something like that. That's because the five-year forecast is fiscal year. These are calendar years.
Yeah.
So it's not going to be a true. If you look and say, well, you told me it was 2.4, what's 6.4 in there? It's because of the blend of the year.
Yeah, that's something we have to watch. Of course, most insurance rates are going up, but luckily, you know, being self-insured and has helped us a
yes,
great deal.
It has.
Yeah.
Good.
And this is what, the fifth year?
Third
year, is that all? Okay. Good job, Bart. Thank you.
Ready?
Yep.
Dr. French?
Yes.
Dr. Nestor Baker?
Yes.
Mrs. Davidson?
Yes. Okay. 7.04, resolution to approve appointment of the audit committee for the fiscal year 2015 state audit. May I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you.
Madam President, members of the board, if you remember, we used to do this resolution in January, but it kind of put people on hold for the whole year. So I think we put in here to change this policy last month to where it has to be approved, I think, by the end of October. So we're bringing it to you now. We have five names. Three of the five names are actually back from last year. There's a Tiffany Stubbs, a Rebecca Vasquez Skillings, and a Michael Howard. If you remember, Mr. Howard is the one who spoke to you last year. They're both returning on the committee. We have two new ones. There's a Charles Randall. He's director of internal audit from the Ohio Bureau of Workers' Compensation. And there's a Miranda Berga. And she works for the Ohio Legal Assistance Foundation. She was also worked in the past in the Office of the Ohio Treasurer. She was Assistant Director of Accounting. So I think there's five really good people on here. They all have CPAs. Rebecca Vasquez Skillings, I think I listed her as a It's a different one. It's an MPA, which I'm not quite familiar with what that is, but.
Master of Public Administration.
Oh, it is? Okay. So she's not a CPA, but they're all very highly qualified, and we're looking forward to having them on. We don't have dates yet for this audit. The audit, for the most part, is completed, but they're going to come back and do the gap part of it. So we don't have a date. It's typically in December is when we go through and do the audit. And for those of you, we'll probably bring that plaque to you next week. We did receive our audit award with distinction last week. And so far, so good on this audit. We should be seeing that again next year.
Good.
So we'll keep our fingers crossed for that one. But we'll bring that to you, that plaque for you at a later date. But this is the committee that I'd like to have you recommend.
Is there any concern that Rebecca Vasquez-Skillings is also a member of the State Board of Education? Is there anything that would suggest that as a conflict in any way?
I don't think so. She basically, this committee, you show up one time, you review the auditors, the audit with the state auditors. They're just there as another set of eyes and ears to ask questions to see how the school districts are doing. So I don't think there's any conflict at all. If there is, we can, well, and this is her third year anyway.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So going forward, even though the policy doesn't have that, know that you can't be on there more than one. This is her third year anyway, so this will be her right. Last year anyway. Mm-hmm.
I don't believe there is. I couldn't think of anything that suggested it, but I don't know all of those ins and outs by heart. Just wanted to make sure that was okay, and she has probably checked that herself.
Dr. Nestor Baker?
Yes.
Dr. French?
Yes.
Mrs. Davidson?
Yes. Personnel consent agenda. 8.01 through 8.08. May I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. And Lori Loftins at the podium.
Good evening, President Davidson, members of the board. Tonight's consent agenda contains 8 sections involving 74 persons. Section 8.01 is the resignation of 5 classified staff. 8.02, we have 1 licensed supplemental resignation. 8.03, change of assignment for 2 classified staff, and then 7 temporary changes of assignment. 8.04, contractual status change for 8 classified staff. 8.05, 1 leave of absence for a teacher. 8.06, we have 1 program for one-time payment for crisis intervention training through the special education staff. 8.07, we have employment of 9 classified staff and 4 substitutes. And 8.08, we have employment of 1 teacher and various supplemental contracts. At this time, I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
I don't have any.
Straightforward.
Yep.
Dr. Nestor Baker?
Yes.
Dr. French?
Yes.
Mrs. Davidson?
Yes. Okay. 9.01, final reading, revised policy 7300, disposition of real estate property and personal property. May I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
We have any questions, comments, concerns with this?
No.
My question is, when did we have I don't recall when we had our first reading. Do you have that on this?
It was, I feel like it was last time.
It was, yeah.
One before?
It was in the summer.
It would have been back farther than the last one.
Yeah,
I just don't remember. Okay. Jeff might remember, I don't know.
A month ago? Are you okay with it, Carol?
Hmm?
Are you okay with
Go
it?
Ahead, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Dr. Nestor Baker?
Oh.
Yes.
Well, I'm sorry, you ready for a vote?
Oh, I thought we were going to have a little more explanation with it.
Oh, we can wait.
Oh, okay.
It's okay, go ahead. Go ahead and ask questions.
My question is, this is Neola, right? Did we get Bricker and Eckler involved here?
Yeah.
And why did we, explain, I don't
August
I just need an explanation.
August 10th.
We did. After reviewing the NEOLA revisions with our legal counsel, we have revised the wording under each header that summarizes the law but does not try to repeat it word for word. Instead, we are making references to the applicable statute for details. and we added some additional references that were not included with the Ohio Revised Code 3313-411 and 413 pertaining to the mandatory offer of unused facilities. And we also included a reference to ORC 5705.1 pertaining to the proceeds from the sale of real property. I have reviewed the edits with my board liaison, Mr. Byrd, and he supports the changes that we've made.
We did use Bicker and Eckler.
We did.
And why was that? We just feel that Neola was not written the way for us, or what was the?
Well, I'm typically the one that's involved with the land deals.
Yeah.
So I'm always referring back to Bricker and Eckler before I execute or bring anything to the board for execution. So I just wanted them to take a look at this before we moved forward. And I had a perspective on it, which they shared, because what Neola did was they were trying to rewrite portions of the code, but it wasn't complete. So when I was reading it, it was somewhat misleading. So if you don't have everything in there. So what we did was we summarized the law under each header and then just made a reference to the statute instead of rewriting the statute.
And I really appreciate that. That's been one of the problems that I've had when I sit here and gripe about Neola, is they throw everything into it, and that isn't necessary in these policy documents. What's necessary is a restatement, as you say, of the statute and the appropriate reference to the statute. Otherwise, it's virtually incomprehensible to wade through. So one of the things that I was pleased when I first read through this in August was, yeah, there's a whole lot of stuff gone.
Yes.
And I'm really, really pleased that we did that. Going through B&E on this one doesn't bother me, because this is so tightly tied to real estate law. So I'm not concerned about that, and I am pleased to see us moving very carefully when it comes to the Neola policies that we're provided with.
Yes, that's my concern too. If they're not meeting our needs, we are additionally paying Bricker and Eckler to rewrite what we need. So that's something that maybe we'll need to have to kind of keep in mind. But they need to understand that they should be writing it based on the law and the standards that they that ORC has. So so thanks. But do you you feel like at this point 10,000, basically, could you explain it just briefly for the audience so that they understand that we can get rid of $10,000 worth of?
Well, there's different levels of authority based on all those headers. For example, property, a personal property, which is the contents, real property being the land. Mm-hmm. But personal property can be disposed of by recommendation by the superintendent. Real property under 10,000 disposed of by the board. When you get into the numbers over 10,000, that's when we go through a series of, and it differs per real property, personal property, for example, whether that's, and the language has changed, as you've seen from the first time I presented, with offers. First offer, for example, for personal or real property over 10,000 would first go to a high-performing community school or a newly established community school. That's round one, and they have 60 days to respond back. Round two is a startup community school or a college preparatory boarding school. That's round two. If that doesn't, if we don't get any offers, then we're able to go to three, which is public auction. And then if we don't obtain any bids from a public auction, the board can sell it at a sale of their choice.
Something I'd kind of like to put on our legislative agenda. I don't like the idea that we have to offer it to charters right off the bat. There aren't charters in this district. There aren't supposed to be, because we're high performing. And we shouldn't be required to offer our properties there.
And our community doesn't want them.
Thanks.
Are you good, Carol? Okay.
You ready?
Thank you.
Dr. Nestor Baker?
Yes.
Dr. French?
Yes.
Mrs. Davidson?
Yes. Thanks, Jeff. Okay, we do not have any old business, new business, 11.01, first reading, revised policy, 5460 were graduation requirements. And Scott Reeves is going to come chat with us.
Good evening, President Davidson, Dr. Kellogg, members of the board. This policy, first reading to adjust and amend policy 5460, which is our graduation requirement, aligns with the Ohio Revised Code and the changes to the graduation requirements effective with the cohort of 2018, which are our current sophomores. And this policy adds language that reflects the new state assessment requirements, earning the minimum number of points in the correct categories for the 7 state assessments that they'll take at the high school level, there's a possibility to graduate and meet the graduation requirements by earning a remediation-free score on a national college admissions test like the ACT or the SAT, or there's the possibility to meet your graduation requirement by earning an approved industry-recognized credential and achieving an appropriate score on a workforce readiness test, which I believe is the work keys. It also adds language to the policy of the requirement for financial literacy, and it also adds language of the availability of the PE waiver. So it's straightforward aligning with the law.
Any questions?
Nope, this is necessary.
Scott, just a point of clarification. So the you mentioned remediation-free score on a college entrance exam like ACT or SAT. Has that been defined for us yet, or is that still in limbo?
I am less familiar with the SAT. We tend to, by far, take the ACT in this region of the country, but the ACT has a defined college readiness cutoff for each of the sections of the ACT, and I don't know them from memory.
But the state hasn't said you have to score this on the ACT and you exempt from the state assessment requirement.
Don't know from memory.
That was one that I've been looking for, and yeah. I didn't mean to put you on the spot, but I don't think they've said on the ACT if you score this, then it doesn't matter how you did on the other state assessments. That's the other path. And then the other one was industry credentials. And I think I'm correct in that's still ill-defined too in terms of what those are.
I think the state puts out a list of the credentials that are recognizable. And I think they alter it either every year or every other year. And I have seen that list, and it's pretty encompassing. Tends to, I'd say, align with what you see in a lot of the career technical centers around the state and the vocational centers.
Work Keys does have it. Work Keys do.
The Work Keys is.
But I don't know what that score is for the Work Keys. Mm-hmm.
For example, I don't think they've defined a student who's in, I'm going to make a simple example, welding at the Delaware Area Career Center. There's assessments that are associated with that, certifications you can earn. I think ODE is in the process of collecting RFPs for what those assessments might be. And the only reason I'm bringing this forward is because, as Mr. Reeves said, this is for this year's sophomore class who already took the 9th grade assessments. Mm-hmm. And I'm still a little uncomfortable about how undefined some of these other pathways are for these kids as they're coming through the system and trying to determine what their pathways is, because the state said there's 3 pathways. One of them is very clear: earn these many points on these state assessments, which, by the way, we just dumped two of and replacing this year, but those scores from last year count for your graduation this year. So this is how a 16-year-old has to process this and explain it at home to mom and dad. Or I can get a remediation-free score on a college entrance exam, which I don't think is defined for us yet, or I can get this industry credential. And so there's a lot of technical term mushiness around what this is for kids, and so any 16-year-old who might be bored and listening to this, do well on the assessments, and you'll be fine. Our teachers are got what they need for them to be prepared on those tests, and that's really where we're at right now. So I know we're still looking for some clarity on some of that.
And our 20 credits, and the categories by which they must meet them are unchanged.
I think it's important to note that, in case anybody is bored and listening to this, we're not bringing this forward prematurely because this policy isn't predicated on those specifics. What it requires of us to do, though, is to include in our policy the fact that those things are pathways. And then we have it in language. It's there whenever the state comes up with the specifics that are required that are not necessary for this policy.
And those are things that could be included maybe in guidelines or something like that?
Yes.
Good. First reading.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, thanks. Okay, up next, 11.02, first reading, new policy 8390, animals on district property. Barbara Wallace is back.
This policy is to approve the addition of new board policy on 8390, animals on district property, to address the conditions under which animals may be present on district property, including both service animals and non-service animals. The new policy is being recommended in accordance with federal and state law, which requires that the district have a policy that includes the legal definition of a service animal, vaccination, licensing, and/or veterinary requirements, the conditions under which non-service animals may be present in the schools, the conditions under which service animals for students may be present in the schools, the circumstances under which a student's service animal may be removed and/or excluded, eligibility of a student's service animal for transportation, and the conditions under which employees, parents, vendors, visitors, and others may have a service animal on district property.
We have had service animals before, I mean,
we
currently,
have.
But this is just new policy that the state wants us to include. All right, thank you. Just for clarification for everybody.
And this is a requirement by the state that we include this policy?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, I'm going to make my standard I'm complaining about NEOLA comment again. There is a lot of, and I know we have a contract NEOLA at this point. Clearly, I want to talk about that in the future. There are things in here that I think would be more appropriate as guidelines. I do not think, for example, that in a policy, it needs to say that the service animal shall remain positioned on the floor at the student's feet. To me, those are guideline pieces, not policy pieces. And going forward, I really want us to focus more on appropriate policy language and appropriate guideline language. And Barb, that has nothing to do with your presentation, and I'm not criticizing you.
Okay.
I'm criticizing NEOLA. Again.
Well, this is feedback that we should provide NEOLA.
Yes.
Because the writers there, those authors, don't understand the difference between policy and guidelines, maybe. So, you know, I would think a lot of schools would be looking at this, actually.
Well, when you make sure that NEOLA knows about this, make sure to write it in about 10 pages.
They get paid by the word.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm joking.
The Melville version.
On a different note, Barbara, correct me if I'm wrong, this... The real changes here is that this is actually a bit more broad than what we're accustomed to in terms of acceptance of service animals in schools, therapy dogs, et cetera. Am I correct?
I think it's the first time we have a definition of what we expect from
right.
a service dog. So, well, you say broad, I would have thought it narrowed it, but.
No.
Thank you.
Okay.
I am pleased with some things in here because there are certain components in here that talk about the humane treatment, the appropriate treatment, the appropriate keeping of the animal, talks about the use of animals that are not service dogs, and applies the permissibility of that. And I do think it's really important that we have that out there. So there's a lot good in here. There really is. My complaints about NEOLA notwithstanding.
Thank you.
Thank you. Standing business, we do not have any, which takes us to public comments, 13.01, and we have three people speaking tonight. Just remember, you have 5 minutes, and up first is Meta Han.
Good evening, members of the board.
First, I want to talk about EpiPens, which was a discussion at the board meeting maybe three or four meetings ago. And I think this EpiPen idea is a bad one. School officials and teachers are not medically trained, are not prepared to diagnose and medicate students. I attended a board meeting and heard the first reading of this proposal, and I understand it was stated statistically 25% of first-time occurrences happen at school, and that those children would not have their own EpiPens. When an allergic reaction happens at school, the squad needs to be called to diagnose and treat the student. And I really do wonder how many first-time incidents have there been in the last few years here in Westerville schools when a squad was called for allergy-related incidents. As a parent of grown children, I would have been very upset if a teacher or any school official other than a nurse would have diagnosed and treated either of my children with an EpiPen. As you know, I'm a retired teacher. When I was teaching, I would have felt incredulous had I been told it would be my job to diagnose and treat a child with an EpiPen. And I don't think any teacher should be asked to do so. In these litigious times that we live, the board should not even consider such an idea. And then I want to also talk about last meeting at the board of the board. You were presented a report on the current status of club fees and pay to play, and a report to increase the number of bus routes, which would require the purchase of additional buses and the rehiring of more drivers. I appreciate that you, the board, ask for proposals and basically more information rather than just increase these contributions. You also ask more information about the bus situation. And as I've thought about these topics, I would ask you to just maintain the status quo. When you consider the limited number of students who would benefit by either an increase in appropriations for pay to play or a ride on a school bus to school, this money just does not need to be spent. Knowing that levy renewals and additional money requests are down the line, as representatives of the taxpayers in Westerville, your job is to watch over the money, not spend it just because it's there. Thank you.
Thank you. Up next, we have Peg Duffy.
Most of us are well aware that the board guidelines say when you're addressing the board, don't use anybody's name. Don't use specific individuals' names. Well, I have to use a name tonight because how else can you say thank you to somebody if you don't use a name? And this is probably going to come as a shock to the individual. Over the decades that Dr. Nestor Baker and I have been yes. I hope everyone saw that. Thank you. Over the decades that we've been following decisions made regarding our schools, as you saw from her expression, we've often been at odds. You're talking oil and water, folks. But Nancy, I have to thank you for last meeting when you used the statement that it seems that we have institutional classism, which is defined in part, quote, attitude or past practice which subordinates people due to income or economic condition, unquote. And we do have that, and we need to work around it so that we can involve more students in choices. Now, at the last meeting, several people talked about, and it's not just pay to play, it's activity fees. They talked about, ask you questions, how many people are involved? What does it cost us? How many people are not participating because of all of this? Now, in our activity fees, as I understand, we have some that are related to credit courses. We have some that are what we traditionally think of as school clubs. Theater is kind of another animal because of the expenses and the rentals on that. And then we have sports, major sports and minor sports. This is something that's going to take a while to resolve how we handle this in an equitable way. Equitable for the kids, equitable for the board budget, and for the taxpayers of the community. My recommendation is that we establish a board committee. Notice I say a board committee to analyze, make recommendations so that we can see what we can do for expanded participation. This committee should have no more than one-third of its members who are employees of the district. Now, I've been on committees where, oh, somebody comes in as, well, I'm a parent in the district. You may be a parent in the district, but you are also an employee of the district, and you're not seeing things strictly through your parent eyes. So no more than a third of them could be employees of the district. And this needs to be a committee of the board where the Sunshine Law applies and we can come and hear what you discuss on it. I urge you to think about that.
Thank you, Peg.
And our last speaker is Jean Trimble.
Good evening, Dr. Kellogg, Madam President, members of the board, Mr. Griffith. Several weeks ago, my husband and I attended curriculum night for all three of our children. Two of our children are in middle school and one is in high school. At the end of the evening, we went home and we compared notes. My husband then loaded all of the online textbooks and various forms of teacher communication to an old used iPad that we have in our home. He loaded Class Dojo, Remind 101, several individual websites, a couple wikis, a Google Classroom. He also created a shortcut to our email account, which we receive weekly updates and newsletters from several other teachers. Like most teenagers, my three children are not the most organized. Writing down homework assignments in their planner is somewhat of a challenge. Remembering to bring home their planner is equally problematic. They all participate in various extracurricular activities, so managing their time to do homework is always a feat. Unfortunately, we learn about missing assignments after their teachers post grades to PowerSchool. At this point, for some teachers, it's too late for my children to succeed with these individual assignments. Currently, there is no one place my husband and I nor my children can go to find upcoming homework assignments for all of their teachers. If my children need help in a specific class, we have to break out the iPad and search for whatever communication tool their teacher is using. If over the weekend we have questions or need a copy of a worksheet, we're sometimes out of luck. We love the fact, don't get me wrong, that all of the teachers of our children have implemented some means of communication with us. However, we feel that there is an opportunity for the district to make communicating with parents and guiding students more uniform, streamlined, efficient, and effective. When my 10th grade daughter goes off to college in 2.5 years, she most definitely will be expected to navigate a learning management system in at least one of her college courses. When I graduated from Kent State University 5 years ago, 95% of my graduate course study was online through a learning management system called Blackboard. I even had a few classes in virtual worlds such as Second Life and the Palace, where I had to create an avatar and that's where we met. Westerville pays for a learning management system called Schoology. Schoology has many wonderful features, including a place for students to contribute to online discussions, a place for teachers to upload worksheets and handouts, a place for teachers to link important websites or files pertinent to their course, a place where teachers can include polls and quizzes, an automatic sync of grades from Schoology to PowerSchool, and most importantly, a calendar. I know several teachers in the district who currently use and love Schoology. They tell me how easy it is for them to communicate with parents and students and how the grade sync feature has saved them countless hours they previously used to grade tests and quizzes. Most use Schoology as basically their course website. I think if more teachers were familiar with Schoology, they too would love it. It is my hope that in the near future, the district will invest more professional development time to this amazing tool and that administration will encourage all teaching professionals in the district to fully implement it. Finally, it is my belief exposing our children to a learning management system now can only be a huge asset and benefit to them in the future when they pursue their college and career goals. Thank you.
Thanks, Jean. Okay, up next, 14.01, board comments. Who wants to go first?
Those guys.
Yeah.
Anybody else?
No, I don't really have anything. I just wanted to thank the speakers once again, their ideas. I appreciate that. I liked several of their ideas. Great.
I agree.
Me too.
I very much appreciate it. Peg, yeah, you got me good tonight. I do appreciate the ideas. There are ideas very much worth considering here.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I echo that. And in addition to that, bravo to Bart and his department on the audit award with distinction. How many years is that? Two?
Three.
Three. Awesome.
This is third.
Okay. Repeat. Nice. Thank you. Dates, times, and location of the next meeting. The board will meet on Monday, October 12th and October 26th at 6 p.m. at the Early Learning Center here at Eastwind. And with that, we are adjourned.
Never mind. Nope.